Welcome to Whatever Works, our unique fortnightly podcast in which we talk about whatever works in our lives and in the lives of our community members. Find us at whateverworks.works. And why not join our community? Simply search for Whatever Works at MeWe.com and get stuck in.
You think I did something bad in another life? I used to be a frog or something.
Oh yeah, that sounds very religious. Probably Hindu or something.
Yes.
Or no, what are the Baha'is?
Yeah.
The Baha'is think about.
I think it is the Buddhas and the Eastern. You keep coming back as different things and it changes depending on how good you've been in your current life. I wouldn't mind being a frog, actually. It'd be less stress than being a film producer.
It'd be all right until you get eaten by a dragon or something.
Yeah. Anyway, shall we start?
Yeah. Being eaten alive. Right.
And on the subject of being eaten alive, welcome to Whatever Works.
Let's roll with that, shall we? Hello, everyone. Welcome to Whatever Works. We like a rolling start, don't we? We're back with show 149. We're nearly at 150. And it's show... it's the middle of November at the moment, so we're here back again. Sorry about the mixed message about the delayed show, but we thought it was delayed and it wasn't, and we're back to normal. I'll shut up now. How are you, Aidan?
Mea culpa, mea culpa. It was me. I'm sorry, guys, with my running around and things getting cancelled because of COVID and excuse after excuse. I'm here. I'm girding my loins to go to Germany again next week, but I'm here and I'm ready to tell you what works in my life.
How is your ailing?
My ailing is weird because I've still got this cough. I'm fine. Thank you very much for asking. I'm no longer in ailment. I am well and fit and going about my day-to-day life, but I've got this wretched cough that won't go away. Maybe it's long COVID, and I say that without joking. I wonder if it is possibly some kind of symptom. I don't know. I'm fine, thank you, but I still apologise if I go on coughing yet again.
Can you taste things and smell things?
I can taste things and smell things, yes.
Particularly yes. Coffee. We have a coffee-heavy show today, don't we?
Never a problem with me, sir.
Right, whateverworks.works is where you'll find all the links to the stuff we're going to talk about today. And MeWe Group is where we try to encourage everyone to natter about whatever works in their life. So do head across there, join in. Links in the show notes if you can't see that anywhere else. Or if you do get lost, tedsalmon.com is where you'll find everything. And aidenbell.com is for Aidan, but don't offer him any work because he's got enough at the moment. Coming up to do Panto and a director's job.
Indeed, yeah, directing a safety exciting. Video in Germany next week and directing Dick Whittington in Boston a couple of weeks after that. There's
Aidan
variety
in
for
work.
You. Thank you,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, well
hey,
done.
Isn't coffee the smell that they use to get rid of other smells? If you're in a posh department store smelling perfume, they always tell you to smell coffee in between to get rid of the smells, and you put coffee in cupboards to get rid of smells as well, don't
right.
you?
I didn't know that, but if it's true, it's certainly a whatever works top tip.
Absolutely. Right, is it my turn? Let me tell you about feedback from Duncan Robertson, who says, now, you may remember I whinged last show about QR codes and ordering with your ready phone with a ruddy QR code in a restaurant when you just want to be with your friends and eat. Duncan
Misery.
Robertson takes a different view. He says, I'm all for ordering using QR codes at pubs and restaurants. They're generally, excuse me, more efficient. And it means I spend more time talking to my friends and my family who I'm with and less time trying to get service at the bar or from passing waiters. If you go to Yo Sushi, you can pay and order online and your food and drink can be delivered via the conveyor belt, so you never have to speak to anyone. You know what? I take a middle ground because my reaction to that is, how awful. What's the point in going out if you don't have any human interaction whatsoever? But yeah, I guess it's something for everyone.
I guess that's the point, isn't it? That, you know, that this is my kind of approach, to be honest, keeping away from keep away from the riffraff and keep yourself to yourself. I suppose the experience of going out is more than interacting with other members of the human race. It's also about seeing different things and changing the four walls and observing what's going on. It's not just about talking
exactly
to other
that was my point last show, Ted, and therefore that also includes looking at the menu, seeing what artwork they've used, in being impressed by the font or not, looking through rather than just staring at a QR code in a phone.
But you could look at that on the wall. I'm sure that these places have got wall menus, even if they haven't got them on bits of paper. Anyway, I don't know. Each to their own, as
Absolutely.
We always say. A fair point, Duncan, and I definitely fall in between the two on that one. So I previously had talked about, I don't know if you remember, but I was cooking eggs in a kettle.
As one does.
And it seems to work really well. We'll come back to that a bit later, actually. But I thought to myself, I'll tell you what happened. My mum's microwave broke down and they had to chuck it away. And I said to her, well, actually, the only thing I use my microwave for these days, really, is making porridge. And you have mine and I'll see if I can find another way around it. So I had decided to experiment with making porridge without a microwave and without a stove, without a cooker, but with just a kettle. And sure enough, it kind of works. So you get some fine porridge oats, not the really thick, fat ones, but some finer ones.
Yes.
And you put them in a bowl with a tightly fitting lid. Pour over about, well, you can add milk, a bit of powdered milk, because if you add real milk, it'll make it cold, too cold,
right.
I think. But if you add a powdered milk and sugar or whatever else you want to put in it or nothing, you can, or in fact, if you're in Scotland, put salt in it. Ugh. I tried that once, and ugh, salt in porridge. Anyway, so you then put the water on it, the boiling water on it from the kettle, seal the lid up, and shut it down tight for like about half an hour, 20 minutes, half an hour, and stir it up again on the way out, and it seems to work. It's not quite the same, to be honest. It's not quite as well done, but it's absolutely edible, and it's absolutely fine.
Is it still hot after 20 or 30 minutes?
Yeah. Well, it's hot enough to eat, for me. It's not piping hot. But that depends also what sort of container you put it into. I mean, if you put it into a metal... if you put it into a flask, say, for example, then if you stuck it in a flask... Actually, I never thought of that. That's a good idea, isn't it?
Try a flask. That'll be your next report.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, the point was, life with a kettle can you. I'm discovering some things that you can do with that. I'll come back to it later. Anyway, who's next?
Well, do you know what? I was going to say that isn't necessarily the sort of thing I would jump to try. But on the other hand, in the old days when I was touring and I would be in hotel after bed and breakfast after guest house and possibly only have a kettle. Wow, I wish I knew you then, Ted. That would have been a great, great, good tips. Thank you, sir.
I'll tell you the other thing I discovered in this whole affair of the microwave was that microwave ovens have gone up in price. When we bought these microwaves, which was about, well, we brought it on the show probably about 3 years ago, they were about, I don't know, 20 quid or 25 quid down at Currys or whatever. And now the cheapest one I could find was 55 quid. And I said to my mother, I'm not paying 55 quid for a microwave just so I can have porridge. Hang it! Anyway, it may be because of Brexit, everything's just gone up in price.
You're right, because while you were talking, I was facetiously looking on Amazon so I could say, nah, 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 that's not true. But you're quite right. You are absolutely right, sir. I was expecting the lower price range too.
Yeah, those are the days.
Anyway, moving on, if you haven't got any money... You can have Christmas dinner in a tin.
Yay!
Christmas dinners in a can promises answers to supermarket shortages, it says here in my recording note. Festive Heinz soup tin contains big chunks of turkey, pigs in blankets, sprouts and stuffing balls. The company will produce 500 cans of the Christmas dinner big soup this year. That doesn't sound much.
Yeah, I thought that might be a misprint.
I think that must be 50,000 or so. I mean, 500, they're going to be on eBay for a fortune. The days of peeling potatoes, prepping sprouts and basting turkey could be numbered if this new festive offering catches on. Again, it is not something I jump at, but again, in the days of if you're in a situation where all you've got is a kettle to do latent heating, or I suppose you'd need a microwave or some sort of a pan to heat this up in, but there you go.
No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't.
You just open the tin and eat it.
No, well, yes, I do do that, and you can do that. It's all cooked inside. But what I was going to say was, coming back to the kettle, you could,
of course,
if you wanted
yes,
to,
hot water,
take the,
yes, yes,
take the lid off of the can of soup, right?
Stand it
in the bottom of the kettle, half fill it with water, shut the lid. Boil the kettle and then leave it for half an hour. And I bet you it'll be... I haven't tried that, but I bet you it'll be...
Do you know what? If you ever did Desert Island Discs, I know what your luxury item's going to be now. A kettle! You'll be sorted for life, Ted.
Yeah. Right, okay. So, incidentally, those Heinz soup cans, tins of food, are really nice. And yes, I do. I'm sure that people will think it's slovenly and lazy, but I do. I'm happy to eat them out of the can. I mean, put it in a bowl if you want to, but just cold. Some things I just don't really want to heat up.
Ooh, move on. Anyway. Some things I can't touch unless they're heated up. Ugh, move on.
John Love is next, and he listened to the last show. Well done, he's our listener. And he was talking about, giving me some feedback on how the Amazon affiliate links percentages works. And I'll link in the show notes to the page he ended up at, which explains what things are the most profitable and what are not. And it seems to be categorised. And the best thing you can get 20% if you get people to buy games, Amazon games. Fashion items are 10%, and on down it goes. Consumables like beer and wine and all that, that's 6%. Digital media, Kindle ebooks, 6%. And then all the way down to 3%, 1%. But there's a clear structure for it, which when I spoke on the last show, I had no idea about. So thank you, John. That's really useful to know. And that table has helped me to, think about which things, if I was going to push things onto people, which I don't want to do, which ones would be the more profitable.
I was just going to say, I can smell some gentle nudging coming in on the show now. We're going to suddenly have lots of Amazon games in review.
Many people on Twitter particularly do that. If you go to Twitter, they pick up on these high yield ones and they just put them in there, and it's basically advertising, but not only for Amazon, but for the person doing it. I'm sure that influencers that's how they make
money. And it comes back to that thing that you and Steve have discussed on PSC before, to do with how much you can really trust a phone review because the person is being paid or benefited by reviewing positively.
Exactly.
And it's the same here then, isn't it? Somebody's suddenly saying, these games are wonderful, you should buy them. And that's actually rubbish. They just want their percentage.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yes, it's a money-go-round, and people are finding innovative ways to earn a living these days because they can't get jobs unless they're a lorry driver.
Well, here's an innovative way of spending some money. Now, on the last show, Ted, you'll remember, and our dear listener, John, will remember, that I got terribly excited by the Lenovo Smart Clock 2, which you brought onto the show, which you have now noticed is only £34.99 if you buy it. I believe it's from Currys. But beware, writes Ted Salmon, this is without the Qi charging plate, and if previous reports are correct, they are not going to sell it separately ever unless they change strategy. Yeah, I've been researching this as well, Ted, because I did get very excited about this. I'm also now concerned, and I started a thread on the MeWe group, and a couple of kind people have responded, and I'm hoping to hear back some feedback about that, because as you know, Ted, I like to sleep in a lead-sealed tomb with neither light nor sound, and so any kind of LED light or anything is going to keep me awake. So I'm very happy with my Google Home because it's completely black, but if I say the OG command, the little LEDs pop on and stay on for about 20 seconds. And then when I haven't said anything else, they go off again. And this is very cunning because it means if I need to get up for a pee in the night, I've just got to say OG and the light comes on and I can go and have my Wii and come back. So I want the Lenovo to do the same. So as I say, some kind people in MeWe are looking into whether that would be the same affair. It did look wonderful. It still looks wonderful. And I'm still extremely tempted. And I believe the list price is $59.99, isn't it? So $34.99 from Currys is, if you can live without the Qi charging plate, go for it, everybody. It looks wonderful.
This is a Black Friday deal. Black Friday is coming up in about 2 weeks' time, but there's an awful lot of people doing early Black Friday stuff, so it's worth keeping an eye on that. You seem to be quite convinced that if you bought one later on eBay or something, you could buy the
plate. I wouldn't say convinced. No? I'm just hopeful. But what I did notice is if anybody, like myself, is desperate to have one now, they are to be found through eBay from America. You can actually buy and because they're so much cheaper in America than they are in the UK, you could get one from America for about 65, 70 quid, which is what I believe the UK price is going to be when the Qi charging plate version comes out.
75.
In the UK, 75?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
so, I mean, the one I found on eBay worked out at, I think, £70.99. So you could actually buy one now from America for the same price that you would in due course pay in the UK. Except, of course, you've got to wait for it to come over from the States and possibly pay customs.
I might actually get one because I am not that bothered about the
The charging. Plate. Oh, good. Yeah, then you can do the test for me with the light.
But the trouble is, I'm still questioning whether is this. I'm going to click through and see if it's still on.
Oh, the offer. Yeah. I mean, well, as you say, if it's pre Black Friday, that should still be on until yes.
It is.
Go I'm on, Ted. Buy one.
Let's see if they they'll deliver it to me. Oh, yeah, they will deliver it to me. 3 to 5 days. Yeah.
Splendid.
Free.
Right.
Free delivery.
You heard it on air, folks. Ted's going to buy one just, and test the LED capacities for
I might just get that but because it does look nice. And I, unlike you, I'd be happy to leave it on all night. That doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah. I mean, I'm assuming that it's intelligent enough to be able to program it to say, you know, switch yourself off at 1 a.m. and come back on at 9 or whatever it is.
I'll tell you when it arrives.
Thank you, sir. What else have you got?
I should test it out fully for you. Just a quick one from Kickstarter. This is a Tuck bike, something I'd never seen before, so I thought I'd mention it. And it is a bicycle, a folding bicycle. We've seen lots of those. We used to have some of those, and they worked really well. But this one even folds the wheels. So typically with folding bikes, because the wheels were the biggest part of the unfolding bit,
yes,
they tended to have small wheels, bikes with small wheels. If you saw a bike with these tiny wheels, that was a folding bike. Whereas this one on Kickstarter, which they're trying to push forward, is... got the wheels folding as well. So they fold into three, and when you see it all folded up, it actually does look very compact, certainly small enough to get into the average car boot, for example. And it just looked really interesting. A new idea and innovative thoughts on folding bikes.
I wonder how good the tyres are, though. If they fold up and unfold, there's going to have to be a pretty good, strong, safe system in order to do that. But as you say, Ted, very interesting. And if you need one to fold up tiny, then excellent.
I think that there's this material coming out these days where tyres will not be full of air.
Yes.
And I can't remember what it's called now, but I read an article about that. But that actually opens up possibilities if you haven't got to put air in your tyres. Ian Barton, Judge Barton, would know all about this.
Yes, I believe that material is called Hope. Ian Barton is actually next, and he brings us... Now, it's a not, the price point is fairly high, but I think if you have the use case, this sounds wonderful. It's a Garmin Varia, I don't know if I said that right, RTL515, and it's a bike light with a radar built in at the back. Ian says it's intended for cyclists and probably isn't much use for anything else. It's a rear lamp that has a built-in radar. If you have a compatible cycle computer, such as Garmin or Element, or maybe that's Element, it will display a stripe down the side of your bike computer. The radar can detect vehicles up to about 100 metres behind you and will display an icon of the vehicle on the computer showing how far away it is. I've had this for about 2 years now and was initially sceptical about how useful it might be. However, I wouldn't go out without it now. It's particularly useful on narrow country roads where it's difficult for vehicles to overtake safely, and you get an early warning that something is coming up behind you. Also useful in towns where you can see how many cars are stacked up behind you waiting to overtake. Now, that's interesting because Ian also links to a video, the first part of which I did watch. I must admit it was quite a long video. I didn't watch it all. But the guy reviewing was saying he didn't find it so useful in town, and it got itself a bit, got its knickers in a twist a bit in town. But Ian seems to have a different opinion there. It looks wonderful. Now, the problem is, dear listener, it's £169. So you've really got to want one of these. But I wish I cycled and I wish I needed one because it's the kind of geeky thing that I'd love to have, a radar for your bike. How about you, Ted? You do bike.
I wonder why it's different to having a camera. Or maybe it the camera is too power hungry or something, and it's too much trouble to do, whereas this radar...
Well, I suppose the camera will only show you an image and you have to decide for yourself how far away it is, whereas a radar will actually give you feet and inches, as it were, to how far away the object actually is from you.
Yeah. I suppose so. Yeah. All very clever stuff, isn't it? Incidentally, Element is a word, and it's some sort of bike computer that Ian linked to.
Okay. So he said you can link it with your Garmin or your Element computer.
Yeah, very good. Thank you, Ian. Good stuff. £169. Yeah, as you say, you'd really have to want one, wouldn't
yes.
you?
Yes.
I really wanted my coffee machine. Here we go. The start of the
it
coffee.
It begins.
The Tassimo I was talking about on the last show, because I thought I got it for £5.
That's
turns
right.
out which I'll come to in a minute. Turns out that that wasn't quite the case. But anyway, the Tassimo Sunny, as it's called, special edition, on sale at Amazon for $29.99. I actually got it for $24.99 because there's a voucher on it, but I think that's gone now. Anyway,
in a very fetching sandy colour, I must add.
Yeah, that's the cream colour, which is the special edition one. You don't normally apparently get it in that colour.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, it works as expected, really. The only downside is that the reservoir is quite small. So if you had a family, you really wouldn't want one with such a small reservoir. Yeah. You just keep filling it up all the time. But it does, for me, living alone, it does 3 mugs of coffee for me. I use the Americano XL, and it does 3 of those. If you didn't have the XL, it would do more, of course. And if you do espresso or whatever, it would do even less. Otherwise, it's great, though. The reservoir is at the back, which is quite annoying traditionally, except that in this case they've thought about that, because if it's up against the wall it's really difficult to get out. But they thought about that, because in this machine they put a little carry handle at the top, and you just pull it out nicely and then carry it across and fill it up and put it back.
I know that my coffee machine, my famous Sage Barista, does that. It's very, very useful, isn't it? I enjoy that function.
Yeah. So, I know that there are purist coffee snobs out there, some not too far away from me now, but to me...
It's a terrible cough I've got.
It tastes absolutely great. I know that there are people out there, and we'll come to Chris in a minute, who will say, no, it's not right. And also, Robert McCrowan is the same. No, it's not right. You've got to do coffee properly. And you'll probably say the same. But to me, it tastes, it's easily as good as the stuff that you buy for £2 a cup down at the local coffee shop. And to me, that is really, really nice coffee. Now, I do get the whole thing, which is, I've now got this AeroPress, which Chris bought for me, and I do use that, and it's nice, absolutely fine, really, really nice. But for me personally, the stuff that I get down at the coffee shop is good enough, and this tastes very, very similar. And it's 12p a cup instead of the £2 down the road, so that's 80 cups for a tenner I worked out.
Yes.
But I each to their own, I suppose. You'll tell me in a minute about your bean to cup stuff and grinding and blah blah blah, and as Greta Thunberg would say. But it's
right. I'm going to come in right now.
Okay.
Can I say, you'll be surprised, Ted. It's coffee and water and milk and sugar if you want it. I think coffee is becoming like wine. I mean, you know, all that sort of refined, gentle hint of oak compounded with an essence of tannin.
Yes.
I'm afraid coffee is going the same way. And again, no disrespect to people like Chris Kelly, who do indeed enjoy making a proper cup of coffee. For me, as long as it's a ground bean and it's in a cup with hot water, I'm happy. So blah, blah, blah to you, sir.
Yeah. Anyway, there you go. I'm very happy with it. And for £25, I thought it was a bargain. Now, I did say that I thought I was getting it for a fiver.
Yes.
Because there were 2 £10 vouchers for coffee in it. But when you open it up and look at this voucher, it says you've got a minimum spend of £25. You've got to order them from the Tassimo website. So I was working out that at the minimum spend of £25, you'd have to buy 5 of them, which ends up being £27.45. The postage was £3.99. Add those together, you get to £31.44. Take away the £10 voucher, and it's £21.44, right, for the pack. The 6 pack, which is more than 5, incidentally, from this Tassimo Direct, the 6 pack in Amazon is £17.50. So it's £4 cheaper to buy them from Amazon. And that's the price without subscribe and save as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So this to this amazing £10 voucher deal was really just a bit of a scam, because you can just get it cheaper elsewhere. But even so, I'm not unhappy, because even for £24.99, I think it's a really, really nice little machine. It does well for me living alone.
I can't disagree, Ted. As I've said, my opinion of coffee is actually very similar to yours. If it tastes good, then that's fine. And yeah, I mean, be careful of snake oil financial offers that aren't really offers at all. But otherwise, no, I think you've done well there, Ted. Well done, sir.
How kind of you to say so. Do carry on.
Thank you so much. Another kind gentleman is Steve Heinrich, who has kindly written to us to say, multifunctional office desk pads are wonderful. Steve says, I recently picked up this multifunctional office desk pad, reversible desktop pad, to protect the refinished tabletop I work on every day. It is essentially a giant mouse pad. It has a leathery, soft feel and texture to it, but the texture is not intrusive, and it's still very smooth, making using it as a mouse pad viable. It's very easy to wipe down as well. Overall, I'm very happy with the look and quality, having chosen the grey over grey version, it says here. Steve chose the grey version over the grey one. Okay, we have a typo somewhere. He opted for the grey version. I believe there are others available.
I think it's light grey and dark grey.
Oh, the grey over grey. I see, having chosen the grey over grey version. Okay, I thought choosing the grey over the grey version. There are lots of colours available. Just read on, Aidan, you ninny. Available, and several manufacturers on Amazon are offering the same product. Here's another with a link he gives us, which will be in the show notes. Yeah, I like the look of this very much. I was really quite tempted to snap one up, and then I noticed it said ultra thin, as if that was a benefit. And as we know from my rants of old, I don't like living in a world where smaller and thinner and tinier is better. I like things that are crafty and hefty and have some weight and some form to them. So ultra thin didn't appeal, but otherwise, this does look like a whopping great big mouse pad and well worth having. What do you think?
The one that I've linked to is not the one that Steve originally linked to in the post, because that one was unavailable. So I tried to find one that was similar. Now, to be fair, the one I've linked to is not double-sided. It's one-sided,
right,
with a rubber base. So it may not be thin as you think it is.
No, that would suit me personally better then. Thank you, Ted.
But I was trying to work out 40 centimetres, whether it would fit in on my desk, 40 centimetres depth by 90 centimetres wide. I guess the width one would be all right, but 40 centimetres deep.
Well, there are these things called tape measures, Ted. If you try one and hold it against your desk. So once again, Ted is now measuring his desk live on it. I tell you what, the one that Ted has found does actually come in a variety of different colours. So I'm just trying to fill dead air for you, Ted, while you're measuring your desk.
And also, it's there's 10% off this one as well. There's a voucher for 10% off. So not only is it reduced from 18 quid to just under 10, but there's another 10% voucher. So it's another quid off, basically.
However, the one that Steve found in the first place is also... Well, the picture's changed as well. Actually, linking to that one, it seems to have changed its imagery and its pictures as well, and also looks more exciting. So there you go, folks. Oversized mouse pads. Well worth looking into.
Yeah. Look, we'll link to two of them in the show notes. And then people can make their own minds up as to which one is the more interesting. Actually, I think the one that Steve linked to originally is the nicer one than the one I linked to. Anyway, there you go. Right, let's get back to coffee. We've been away from it for too long.
At least 5 minutes, yes.
Chris Kelly has bought the Fellow Ode Brew Grinder. For some time, I've been hand-grinding my morning coffee beans, and I've decided to go electric. I've opted for the aforementioned Fellow Ode Brew Grinder.
Oh, one of them.
I love the minimalistic aesthetic, which has a hint of the obelisk from 2001. It's reassuringly heavy at 4.5 kilos. You'd like that. There's a huge dial on the front that goes up from 2 to 11 at the course.
Oh, Steve Litchfield would like that.
Yeah. I've set it on the finest setting. This is the biggest drawback of the grinder. It doesn't do really, really fine. So espresso is not an option, says Chris. What it does do is produce a very consistent grind, very quietly and really quickly. This is due to the large flat burrs. We're going to get technical now. So what used to take around 40 seconds now takes about 6 seconds. The Ode is intended to deliver a single dose, so there are no large hoppers on the top, which means it has a low profile, not much taller than my coffee mug, he says. The bin that catches the grounds has a magnet in the base, which satisfyingly snatches it from your fingers to centre it under the output chute. It has a, I hope you're keeping up here, it has a smallish start-stop button on the lower front right corner, but it senses when there's nothing left to grind and auto-stops after a few seconds. All in all, I think it's a well-designed, made and made grinder, and after a couple of weeks of use, I can confirm that it works superbly. At a mere £290... I also think it's a bargain. He thinks that's a bargain.
Oh.
Well, it's compared to my hand grinder. So presumably the hand grinder cost even more.
Oh,
£290. Wow. It does look nice, to be fair. It looks really nice. And if the whole coffee thing, going back to what was said before earlier, if the whole coffee thing is your hobby and you really get great pleasure out of it, then £290 is a budget mobile phone. So, you know, good for Chris.
£290 to save 34 seconds on grinding your coffee. No, but seriously, folks, again, as we say, if it's something that gives Chris pleasure, that he enjoys using and gives him the coffee that he wants, then absolutely, why not? No, money well spent. If you've got that money, spend it.
And he doesn't have to use his elbow anymore to do it manually.
Or once a year.
Ted's Top Tips.
Ian Watson is back.
Yay.
And says, following Ted's porridge thing, I get the reduced bunches of bananas from our local co-op for less than 10p and freeze them. The very ripe ones are great to put in porridge. There's a top tip. And, Ian says, going on, I tried eggs in the kettle a few times after Ted suggested it. When one of the eggs cracked, it left a white scum around the kettle. So now I use my air fryer. There you are,
ooh,
you see.
Right.
So I love all this outside-the-box thinking, cooking eggs in an air fryer.
Why not? That sounds really good. I'd like to see how that's done. The cracked egg thing, I think I said before, it happened to me once. But to be fair, it was easily cleaned out. It wasn't a big problem. It never happened again. It was probably a cracked shell on an egg or something. Also, I've discovered that you can use a roasting bag. And if you are fearful about that, you know these roasting bags you get from Sainsbury's?
Yes.
Yeah. If you put the egg inside one of those, apparently you can put that in the kettle. And so if it does explode, then you don't get mess everywhere. And also, the other thing I discovered was that you might be too posh for this, but if you go to Sainsbury's, you can buy fish in a bag. Boil in a bag fish, right?
I'm too posh to Sainsbury's, darling. I go to Waitrose, of course.
In the old days, I used to get these bags, and they were great. You put them in boiling water.
Oh, I know
and you
these.
Didn't.
Yeah, lovely.
Yeah,
lovely.
You didn't have to break the bag open unless you were going to be microwaving them, right?
Yep.
So if you're going to put them in boiling water, you left them sealed.
Yep.
And these things you can chuck in the kettle as well. So the same thing applies, latent heat. So don't expect it to be done in 5 minutes. But if you put it into boiling water in the kettle, leave it for half an hour or something, and the thing will...
Yes.
Will latent heat cook itself. So, yeah,
but
absolutely.
We should stress, don't have the kettle on, because the actual heating element will wreck the plastic.
No, you can't.
Only
you can't
heat.
Use.
Only,
you can't use a kettle. No. You can't use a kettle with a heating element. It's got to be one of these ones where the element.
Oh,
is not
okay.
Exposed.
Even more safety conscious. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. We said that on the last show, because one of the things they said was that if you use one for doing eggs, is that it burns the shell of the egg if it's got an element.
Right.
So yeah, you need a flat bottom kettle.
Okay. Have you got a dishwasher, Ted?
No, not personally.
Oh, I've got to say, because I know you'd be the kind of person who'd be wrapping potatoes in silver foil and putting them in the dishwasher.
And fish. We tried fish once.
Yes, fish too.
You can put a fish in the dishwasher and cook it, yeah. There is some innovative ways. I was focusing on kettles because that seems to be the lowest common denominator. Everyone's got a kettle.
Yes.
And the more stuff you can think about. There's also these salmon things you can get. If you buy salmon from Iceland, again, probably far too common for you, but in Iceland they sell salmon.
I'm going to duff you up, you know.
And each of these salmon fillets is in its own bag,
yes.
Same as the, you know, and you can just chuck those in there as well, but don't open it first, obviously.
I watched a TV programme not long ago where they cooked a meal under a car bonnet.
Oh, yeah,
They prepared a meal and they stuck it under the bonnet and then drove up the motorway for an hour and then the dinner was ready. It was a lovely idea.
Yeah. Amazing, isn't it? And we've all probably seen the people in the likes of Cairo cooking eggs on stones.
Yes.
Because it's just so blooming hot. Or in Saudi Arabia.
Yes. Anyway. And they do it in America. You crack an egg onto a car bonnet and fry it and that sort of thing.
Innovative ways of cooking. I was actually quite pleased that the microwave went away, so I started to think out of the box a bit and find other ways of doing
things. You could probably
things.
Just put an egg down and talk to it for a long time, Ted, because I think hot air would probably have the same effect.
How rude. Right, I've been rethinking time as well in my TED's top tips. I wonder if people could live with one of these innovative clocks. One of the clocks I linked to in the MeWe post has has one hand on it, and the face of the clock is divided up into seven segments, one for each day, and the hand goes round. So instead of you knowing exactly what minute and hour it is, it points to in this case it's sectioned up into 6 hour slots. So the hand in this question, in this point, is pointing to Friday, and you can see that it's just after the first 6 hour segment. So it's 6:15 in the morning on Friday, and it just seemed like an interesting, different way of thinking about time and how we look at time. And do we need to know the exact absolute minute is? Well, obviously, for some things, if you've got a doctor's appointment, you need to. But generally speaking, perhaps we don't need to be so hard and fast about these things. There's also another interesting clock face. These are from a company called, Day Clocks, and that they've got a few designs, and it's quite interesting. So the other one I've linked to is not, instead of getting 1 to 12 around it, it's got 1 to 24 around it. This one does have minute hand and second hand as well, but instead of it pointing in the traditional way, in this case it's pointing to what is it pointing to?
I found these fascinating, and I would be very happy to have either of them on my wall. The first one I love. It goes round once a week.
Yeah.
The second one, it is harder. I think the second one, the 24-hour one, there is a learning curve involved. You have to stare at it for a little while to work it out. But basically, you've got 24 sections instead of 12.
I know what it is.
On the inside,
The inside ring,
gives
that's
you
right.
the minutes, yes.
So it's 10 past 8, yes. Isn't it? So it's pointing to 4:20 and it's 10 past 8.
So actually, that one is still pretty accurate. You could get your doctor's appointment from the second clock.
Yeah.
But I really do enjoy the first one, Ted, very much. That only goes round its face once a week. And as you say, you don't need to know to the very minute. You know, it's roughly mid-morning on Friday, and that's sufficient for a lot of people.
Yeah. Indeed, for a lot of situations. So anyway, just interesting, different. You know, it's probably to do with slowing down and not working so much, and deadlines are not that critical when you're not at work any longer, I suppose.
We could call it the lockdown clock.
Yes. Right. Let's move on. I wonder who bought this, which is going back to coffee.
Never! More coffee!
I told you it was the coffee show.
You did indeed.
The AeroPress that I referred to earlier, which Chris Kelly kindly bought me and is still in use, they brought this new one out called the AeroPress Go. Well, I don't know if it's new, but it's new to me. And it is a travel version of the AeroPress. As if the AeroPress wasn't travel-friendly enough, they brought another one with a smaller, lighter footprint. Now, apparently, according to the original, the Go is shorter, meaning you make slightly less coffee. Mm-hmm. However, the plunger, according to this particular reviewer, is far superior on the Go. It fits better into the chamber, generates less leakage, and slides more smoothly. The Go has some weight to it, says this reviewer. The accessories pack away into the included mug very neatly. So I think possibly the packing away of it gets you into a smaller... Mind you, the one that Chris sent me comes with its own carry bag, and it's really not very big.
Right.
But yeah, this
they just wanted to make a bit more money.
Smaller.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. It's the same 30 quid in cost as the original, but the... this reviewer said it's better in some ways, certainly in the ways we've just described. Anyway, someone bought that, so thank you very much. Interesting one. It's called the AeroPress 10R11 Go travel coffee maker. And thank you so much, everyone, for buying stuff with my Amazon affiliates link. If you want to do that, you can do that by pointing your Amazon at tinyurl.com/TED. Amazon TED UK. Thank you so much.
And breathe. I'm sorry, dear listener, you may have noticed I haven't brought a lot to the show. I'm running around being busy, so I'm letting Ted bring things. What have you brought
Working.
To Cheapest Chips, Ted?
Being productive for the country, well done. While I loaf about, mucking about with podcasts.
Not at all. What has your loafing found us, Ted?
£4.85 for Olbus oil. Olbus oil is great, particularly in the summer, I find. It keeps your sinuses clear for those like me who have blocked sinuses. Anyway, the point was that this Olbus oil on Amazon is £4.85 on Subscribe and Save. And I looked in various outlets, including my local Boots, £6.50. So it's a right rip-off everywhere else. Asda and Sainsbury's, same thing, same kind of price, £6, over £6, £4.85 on Subscribe and Save. It is just over a fiver if you want to buy just a one-off, but significant saving to be had. And Olbus oil is great. It's a real natural product, keeps your sinuses clear, no need for tablets and chemicals and medication. It's a really good natural product.
Very good, Ted. I was just having a look. I've never used Subscribe and Save, and I was just wondering how often they're going to throw a bottle of oil at you. But you can go up to 6 months. I was thinking you'd have to get through a lot of Olbus oil to do a Subscribe and Save. But not at all. 2 weeks, 1 month, six, two, three, and then 6 months, 6 weeks, up to 6 months. So
I was trying to work out how often I need to do that with my coffee to get it a bit cheaper.
Yes.
And I reckoned that I'll get through a six-pack thingy in about... If I have one cup a day, it will take nearly 3 months. But if I have two cups a day, obviously 6 weeks. So I'll have to choose one of those things you've just described.
There you go.
I want one, I want one, I want one.
I want one of those.
It's me. I've actually got something. I found these the other day, and I'm being a cheapskate here, because I'm bringing on to I Want One of Those something that actually only costs £8.99. So really, you could just say, for goodness sake, Aidan, just buy them. But I don't want to spend money on Anslav lazy reader glasses. Do you remember when we were kids and there was that thing in the back of the Beano called the sea bacuscope that you could look round corners? It was some strange...
No.
It was a sort of periscope affair that they sold for kids.
Okay.
The idea was you could sort of look into it and look round corner and see your mates, and they didn't know you were looking at them. Some silly little thing with mirrors. Well, this is something similar. This is a pair of glasses, no doubt cheap plastic horrible glasses, but they've got mirrors at 45 degrees, which means you can lie down on your back and hold your book or your iPad or your phone at your waist and look up... And read it, because you're getting a reflection. So really, it's glasses for the extraordinarily lazy. As I say, I mean, I don't want to pay anything. I just love to have a pair and put them on and go, goodness, these are stupid, aren't they? And take them off again. They just struck me as amusing. And on my continuing my theme of glasses from the last show, I thought I'd bring you these Anslav lazy reader glasses. They got one of these lovely long names at Amazon. Anslav lazy reader, lazy glasses, horizontal glasses, relaxed glasses in black, non-magnetic, creative, 90-degree angle bed prism spectacle glasses. Read in bed while lying flat. So there we are. I was wrong about the 45 degrees. It's 90, of course. There you go.
This is the same principle as an SLR camera, isn't it?
It really is, yes. SLR glasses. There you go.
but I wonder how they stop the image from being the wrong way around. Because if you apply it to two eyes...
Good thought, Mr.
I'm not a physicist.
There must be two mirrors in there.
Yeah.
Very good thought.
Unless
they just don't bother. Maybe they don't. No, because it's sold for reading. I mean, if it was sold for looking, I could understand.
Yeah.
Well, I guess one of us will have to take a punt and find out.
Yeah, £9. You can take the punt on that one.
That was my thought entirely. Maybe we'll just
I'd rather spend £399 on a... You'll love this. This is a Project T1 turntable made of walnut.
Oh, yes. Oh, and it's got that lovely sort of, smoked plastic lid that I remember of old from these things.
Forget the lid. stick with the walnut. Can you imagine having something made of beautiful wood like that?
Yes.
This is not just an old-fashioned kind of thing. This is an up-to-date turntable. It's a Bluetooth turntable with a preamp built in with wireless audio streaming. Now, the implications for that are that you don't have to plug speakers into it. It's got its own built-in Bluetooth output.
So you can partner it up with all the Bluetooth speakers you've ever reviewed on the show.
Exactly, and you can and you don't have to have this thing apart from power. You don't have to have it connected to anything. Now, of course, the purist is not going to want that. They're going to want to have their own amplifier and their own speakers and blah blah blah. But for me, with my being happy with a Tassimo coffee machine mentality, this would do me nicely. Very heavy chassis, apparently.
Good.
There's no spaces in it. There's no plastics been used in the construction. It's a solid piece of walnut, and it just looks lovely. There's no way that I would spend £400 on a turntable, particularly as I've got two already, which are underused, I have to admit. But it's just anything made of wood. We've done wood before, haven't we? So many times.
Yes.
Anything made of wood, you think lovely wood, and not only wood, but walnut. Wouldn't you just like one to sit in the corner?
Oh, God, yes. And like other items we've talked about not so quite recently, it's that old meets new. It's that traditional old technology meets new technology in a good and satisfying way. Again, I mean, it's the same. It's back to that, to the refined gentle hints of oak in the wine rubbish. I agree with you, too, with audio. The audio files, it's all a bit silly and pompous. As long as you can hear it and it sounds decent, then that does the job. Yeah, I want one, too. But again,
I'm going to take a recording of that and play it back to you. what you just said. As you tell me that the files for our podcast are too small, they won't be any good.
I'm talking about Aidan Bell listening to his music. I'm not talking about professional production, darling. I like this very much, Ted. I wish it wasn't £400 quid. But again, like you, I don't really have a use case. I've got a huge collection of old LPs, but I don't even play them at all, never mind occasionally. Yeah, yeah. So
I have to make myself, to be honest. I have to purposely sit down and say, you're not using this. For goodness sake, sit down and put a record on. And then I do. And it's great. And I enjoy it. But yeah, you're right. There's so many simpler ways of doing things these days.
Yes, I wish I was still using it. See what I did there?
Very good.
Still using and still using.
I'm still using silicone travel bottles. I brought these onto the show.
You and your links.
Me and my links. Of course.
You and your hooks.
Of course. Silicone travel bottles I brought to the show on the 16th of November 2019, show 95. You may remember, I remember being silly and telling you how sexy they were, and they must be made out of the same rubber as sex toys because they feel glorious. And I only have one. Did I buy three? It seems to be that you can buy three. In that case, I've lost two of them, I have to confess. But one of them sits in my travel case. It's got my shampoo in it. It travels with me. I use it when I'm abroad. And I've never had any spillage with it. I've never had any problems with it. It's 75 milliliters, so I can fly with it without them confiscating it. It's great. It's a very nice, cute, sexy little bottle for, in my case, shampoo. But in your case, whatever you want to put in it. Coffee, wine.
Cannabis. Yes.
Nothing more to say. Sexy silicone travel bottles, very nice.
Except you can't buy them. hang on a minute. There's another lot for $6.99, but they're not the same colours.
Well, there was nothing in the in the small print about you can only bring onto the show what you're still using, sale. I'm just telling you what I'm still using.
I totally agree with you. It's just that it's a shame that they can't still be bought. But if you click on the link top left, there's another set which look really, really exactly the same, but they're just not, they're bright colors.
Oh, I found the set in pink, orange and blue. And they look identical, so if you can stand the garish colors, then they're probably equally sexy.
Very nice. I do like them, as I said at the time. It's just that I never go anywhere, so
So stay at home and listen to your £400 record player, Ted, and be happy.
Yeah. Brought this. I couldn't find it, but I know that I brought this to the show, and I can't tell you which show it was. But it's a really simple USB flexible LED light thingy that I use as a bedside lamp. I've moved the bedside lamp LED that I brought to the show a few shows ago. I've now moved into the lounge because I've found a better place for it. So this one, I remembered I got it in a drawer, and I got it out and I put it by the bed, and it's really nice. It works really well. It's got 10 LEDs on it. It's not hugely bright, but for the bedside, it works really well. I don't need a huge amount of light. I don't read proper books like you probably do. So most of the things I'm doing in terms of reading in bed are backlit screens. So it works really nicely. And apparently it uses at least 75% less electricity than a traditional bulb. So I thought, why am I sitting there with this old-fashioned bulb glowing and wasting electricity? So it works really well. Plug it into a USB socket into any device you've got handy, including a plug in the wall, which is what I do. You tap the end of it with a finger to turn it on, turn it off. There's no different colours. There's no degrees of brightness. It's just simple. It just works. The bad news is that, a bit like your travel bottles, they don't sell them. Yeah, you can't get them anymore, which is a shame because it works really well. I think they've moved now towards these other ones that have got all these different shades and the rest of it, and the simple ones seem to have disappeared a bit because I guess they've got cheaper to produce and what have you. So yeah, anyway, there it is. I'll link to the show in the show notes anyway, even though you can't buy one.
You've been a fan of Gooseneck for quite a while. This stuff, do you know? Yeah. I swear you brought this onto the show quite recently, but maybe it was just a different LED light at that time.
I think it was a different one. Yeah, we got one from my mum for a jigsaw.
Oh, that might be the one. Okay,
This is a much simpler one than that, and it works fine.
Certainly LED rocks. I mean, during the course of being a presenter of this show, I've gone from cursed LEDs, hate them, to aren't these LEDs great? You know, one has had to get used to the newfangled
Indeed.
Technology.
Now, my mouse ran out of battery this week, and it reminded me that these Amazon Basic mice, are just brilliant. I looked up my buying history on this. I used to buy them for my staff when I was at work, and I just issued them to everyone. None of them ever went wrong. They're only about a fiver each, and they're just superb. They're very simple. They got two buttons and a scroll wheel, and they just work brilliantly. Two AAA batteries, hurrah, you stick inside it, and they just don't go wrong. The one that I've got in my hand that I'm still using, and I put the new batteries in, I looked it up, and I bought it in November 2011. So it's exactly 10 years old.
Ah, wow.
And it's still going, still plugging away. Nothing goes wrong with them, really. They're really, really good. Again, the bad news is they don't seem to be available anymore. These things they don't stick with. Well, I suppose
yeah, 10
years
later,
come on. But it's a shame you can't get them because they really are excellent. And I can imagine that whatever's the replacement now is not as good because they never are they?
I had a lovely message from my sister the other day. We were chatting on Facebook and then suddenly she sent a few bits of nonsense through and said, "Sorry, I just dropped my mouse on my cat."
Oh.
Yes?
It's back in stock.
Oh, goodness. I thought something had happened. There we are, ladies and gentlemen.
No.
The 10-year-old mouse has returned. You can buy one, and Ted will provide link in the show notes.
The bad news is, though,
it's £480.
Oh. Yeah, it's not a fiver any longer. It's £12.30.
Oh, come on. That's still very, very good for a mouse.
Yeah.
For a mouse that's going to last you for a decade.
But they used to be cheap as chips as well as still using.
But not Room 101. Andy and Barton returns once again with an SD card packaging rant. Ian says...
All stand for judge.
Barton. Ian says, why do SD card manufacturers make it so hard to remove the card from the packaging? And Aidan says, hear, my lad. I couldn't agree with you more. Cutting the cardboard, says Ian, and trying to peel off the plastic, even when it's supposed to have an ear to pull, almost always fails. I end up cutting the plastic bubble close to the card, trying not to damage it, while trying to prize the blasted thing out of its bubble. Yeah, I totally and utterly agree with you, Ian. We've talked about this sort of thing on the show before. Packaging that's put together that you really need a degree in engineering to open. And, you know, Lord help you if you want to package it up and return it afterwards. Don't even go there.
The things that I have to get a knife to, which you shouldn't have to. So you buy stuff like coleslaw or microwave curry thingies, and there's a cellophane over the top, and there's a tab, like Ian says, there's a tab, and you start to pull the thingy, and it just comes off in a rim around the edge.
Yes.
You have to get, you just got to get a sharp knife and cut. So why bother? Why not just say in the instructions, get a sharp knife and cut it off?
Stupid
people. Amazon had a campaign a few years back about frustration-free packaging, but where they were asking for feedback. But it seems sort of fizzled out now. They've obviously thought better about it.
Well, my rant. People who send social media messages, you know, you're chatting, there's a multitude of platforms now. You and I chat on Hangouts, Ted. I chat with my sister on Facebook. I've got friends on WhatsApp. But there's a problem that seems to be across all platforms, which is people who send messages a line at a time. People will write, "Hello, Aidan, return. I got your message. Return. I think we might do that. Return." And you just keep getting little message after little message. And if you've got any kind of notification on, if you're quietly watching the television, your phone is having a merry fit with notification after notification. Why can't people simply write the message and then send it? That's all. It's a simple rant. I finished.
One of the reasons, and actually when you and I are talking on Google Chat, one of the reasons I think people are tempted to do that is because while you're typing something in reply to the last person's message, they then jump in with another message and usurp what you were typing.
Oh, yes, I can understand that. That's a sort of crosstalk where I'm just talking about somebody who might send an entire paragraph and I'm not even available at the time, but they'll send it line by line because people don't realise that with many of these systems, when you hit the return key, it doesn't go to the beginning of the next line like a typewriter. It sends the ruddy thing.
Yeah. I understand what you're saying, yeah. And while we're talking about that kind of communication issue, I want to throw into Room 101 people who use the subject line in emails to put their blooming message in. They just start typing their message in the subject line, for goodness sake.
I'm going off subject lines in emails anyway, because what tends to happen is I'll send you an email called recording ? Because I want to ask you whether we're recording on a certain day. And then we'll have a conversation and we'll start talking about making a new jingle, whatever it is. And suddenly we're discussing something in a conversation that's called recording that's got nothing to do with recording. So
that's if you use threaded emails. If you don't use threaded emails, if you use one by one emails, we have got into this kind of conversation mode, and Google encouraged that by default. I think that Gmail accounts now. I know you don't use Gmail, but Google have encouraged this conversation threading view. But you can turn it off.
No, I don't use any kind of threading. I'm just talking about if I send you an email with a subject and you send it back, it will say re:subject. And if I then reply to you and say, "Oh, and while we're chatting, I need to ask you about how to cook a haggis," you'll still get an email that's called recording, but I'll be asking you about how to cook a haggis.
Okay. That's all. Right, okay. Yeah. I don't know if there's a way around that, really, because you can't change subject lines.
I'm starting to just not bother with subjects or give them something absolutely arbitrary, like umbrella, just so that it's got nothing to do with anything.
Or you could just put the date stamp in it.
Or hello.
Saturday, which I sometimes do, actually. Anyway, I'd like to now introduce the best jingle that you've ever written.
Was very kind, Ted. Normally I feel that jingle is too long and I try to talk over it because I think, goodness, but I've let it play in full this week, thanks to your kind words.
I tell you what I like about it the most is that it's really bassy and deep. the bass resonates through it, and it's it stands aloft. From
I
the
thank
others.
You, Ted. It is actually my homage to a lady composer whose name eludes me, who did the music for the Harry Potter plays in London. I'll try and think of her name before we finish the recording, and it's an ode to her. It's a tribute to her. But thank you very much indeed. So I'm beaming. So give us a room 10. Get me a room. Tell us about Gold Star. Oh, is it me? It's me. You've thrown me completely, Ted. You see what happens when you compliment me? I lose the plot entirely. Harry T on Pebble Time Watch. I remember Pebble Watches. I remember listening to you and Steve talking about Pebble Watches, and a lady called Miriam somebody who worked for Pebble and then didn't and then couldn't tell you anymore. And goodness me. Harry says, my Pebble Time smartwatch is still going strong in late 2021, brought out in 2015. Now paired to my iPhone 7, which is also still going strong. Wow, that is a long time, because Pebble was the original. Yeah. It used the ink, what do you call it? Paper ink,
e-ink.
Goodness. Yeah. Well, good for you, Harry, for sticking with Pebble.
Yeah, and it was a Kickstarter campaign when it started.
That's right.
Off.
Yeah.
And they did really well initially, and as you say, Miriam Joar was on board with them, and it was all going really well, it seemed. But people wanted smarter and slicker and OLED screens and blah blah blah. One of the big benefits of the Pebble Watch was that the battery lasted forever. Everyone around them, like Samsung and whoever else was bringing out watches, they were lasting like half a day, and you had to charge them up again.
Right.
Whereas Pebbles.
Yes.
Were not, and they were the battery was excellent, and they didn't try to do anything more than the simple notification. They just got more and more complicated. And I had a Pebble watch, I had a couple of them, and they were really nice. And so I'm really pleased that you still have got yours, Harry, and it's still going. Well done.
Imogen Heap. Imogen Heap.
Ah.
That's the lady.
Okay.
Marvellous, wonderful modern composer, and she wrote the music to the play Harry Potter and the Cursed Child.
Oh, that rings a bell, actually. Yeah, that rings a bell.
Very clever, very clever, very modern, full of electronic noises and strange sounds and clever ways of recording. And so the Gold Star was a slight homage to Imogen Heap.
Okay, I'll put that link into the show notes to the wiki page for Imogen.
Excuse me.
Imogen Heap. My last Gold Star of the week and last item is Asda Daytime Drivers, a cut above the rest. And I think I might have told you this before about the gate. I said one of the drivers that arrived, don't worry about shutting the gate when you come in because you're only here 5 minutes. Oh, no, sir. He called me sir. No, sir. I always do that. It's, we close the gates because it says close the gate on it. No. And I thought, you people are good. So much different to the ones that I used to use in the evening. I think the evening drivers are just, I don't know, they're a different breed.
Yeah.
Maybe the people that are better trained and professional or whatever, that are the daytime people.
Yes.
But anyway, since I've switched to daytimes, I've got no complaints at all about Asda. They do a really, really good job making deliveries.
I think during lockdown you gave a Gold Star to a Waitrose driver once who you were so happy found you without any problems, whereas all the others I can't find you.
That was let's not say who that was. And he couldn't reverse
That's
his van
fine.
Either. Oh, good grief. Anyway, there you go. We're done, I think. We're up to the hour, and we'll be back again in 2 weeks with another slap up version of Whatever Works. In the meantime, you can find the show URL at whateverworks.works, which is the main website. Links to all the stuff we've been talking about shoot out from there. If you get lost or you want to join the MeWe group and you don't know where that is, head for tedsalmon.com. Links everywhere from there. Aidenbell.com for Aiden. And the MeWe group, yes. Do come and join us in the MeWe group. It's great fun, and you can share with us whatever works in your life. We'll bring the highlights of that to the shows coming along, so do that.
Absolutely.
Anything for you to say before you start coughing?
No, sir. Don't put the thought in my head. You did admirably in my slight absence this week. Thank you, Ted, and I hope I'll be firing on all cylinders next time.
We'll look forward to it. So, one last thing to say. Don't forget,
whatever works,
works!
Even if you can't buy it anymore.
Yeah.